I don't care what you've heard or what somebody has led you to believe, there are such things as stupid questions. In fact, there's lots of them. And it's important to be able to read the whole scope of a situation, or you are probably going to blow it. Hello, everyone. I'm Jen Mueller, author of The Influential Conversationalist and your conversation coach. The way that you handle day-to-day interactions has a chance to set you apart and demonstrate that you are ready for more responsibility. And you've got to be able to see the whole scope of the situation to read it right and to know where you fit in. It's a big part of making sure that the conversations I have with the athletes that I work with go smoothly. Now, I call them conversations, you call them interviews, and you see examples of them all the time, whether it's me or another sideline reporter. And you know what makes a good interview, because no doubt you have sat at home and watched an interview and thought, that was a really stupid question. Or you witnessed a terse exchange between a reporter and an athlete and thought, I wonder what else is going on there. You've also probably experienced this in your workplace. Somebody's asked you a stupid question, and in the back of your mind, you're thinking, what in the world are they doing asking me that question? Or you've had an exchange that hasn't gone your way, and you're trying to figure out how to fix it. Well, lucky for you, I've experienced both of those scenarios, and I've got a few ways to help. Here's what I've learned about making sure that you've considered the situation and you're building a good relationship. You need to make sure that you're starting with the same point of reference. You know what you're thinking, but don't assume that the other person can read your mind and knows exactly what you're talking about. You should avoid stupid questions. You know, the ones that you might find somebody asking at an icebreaker function type of thing. You know, if you were a tree, what kind of tree would you be? Who cares? That's really not going to get you very far in the relationship building process. You also need to identify if there's a better way to say something. Look, I know what you meant to say, but if it comes out and it sounds accusatory, or you know, it sounds like you're blaming somebody, there was probably a better way to phrase that. Practice saying it out loud. I talk to myself all the time. Some people would consider it a bad habit, but here's what else I'm doing. I'm making sure that the words that sound good in my head actually sound good when they come out of my mouth. Oh, and that I can actually say them without stumbling over them. You also need to make sure that you are not watching the clock. When you follow this list and the conversation strategies in Chapter 3 of The Influential Conversationalist, you will build rapport and develop good relationships. Here's why this is important. Because when relationships are bad or non-existent, in my world, an athlete might look for a way to make me look bad at every turn. They would look for the negative in every question. Their answers would be short, terse, and combative. If I've got a good relationship with the athletes I work with, it means that if I ask a stupid question, they're probably not going to point it out during an interview. They're going to look for the positive, and they are going to help me save face. But it doesn't happen without a level of trust and respect, and that starts with rapport. Here is your leadership takeaway. An influential conversationalist considers how the other person is receiving the information and the general context of the situation. Of course, there is much more about that in The Influential Conversationalist, because your conversation skills really can develop your leadership potential. Pick up the book on Amazon.